We start with the politics lead today, and President Trump's continued mixed messages and confusing statements on North Korea. Just now, in the Rose Garden, the president offered even more commentary on the Wall Street Journal report that Kim Jong-un's murdered half-brother Kim Jong-nam had been working with the CIA. Now, yesterday, the president said such a thing would never happen, quote, under my auspices, a remark that many national security experts interpreted as the president seemingly siding against his own intelligence agency in favor of the brutal dictator of Pyongyang. Today, the president was asked to clear up that remark, but what he said only obfuscated matters further.
You seem to suggest yesterday that you are essentially committing to not spying on North Korea. Is that what you meant? Were those comments interpreted accurately?
No, it's not what I meant. It's what I said, and that's, I think it's different than maybe your interpretation.
It's not what I meant, it's what I said. For the record, here's what the president said.
I saw the information about the CIA with respect to his brother or half-brother, and I would tell him that would not happen under my auspices, that's for sure.
The confusing comments coming as the president tries to save his relationship with the North Korean dictator, who has so far committed to nuclear ambitions. CNN's Abby Phillips starts us off today at the White House.
President Trump pulling out all the stops for Poland's President Andrzej Duda, ordering a rare fighter jet flyover of the White House before his Rose Garden press conference today.
And actually came to a pretty close to a halt over the White House.
But it was President Trump's comments about North Korea and the next steps with Kim Jong-un that raised eyebrows.
Strong force. We're the strongest force in the world, but that's a strong force.
President Trump not offering much clarity on his comments yesterday when he said he wouldn't allow the CIA to use Kim Jong-un's half-brother as an informant.
No, it's not what I meant. It's what I said, and that's, I think it's different than maybe your interpretation. I think we're going to do very well with North Korea over a period of time. I'm in no rush.
Minutes earlier in the Oval Office, Trump slamming reports that his campaign's internal polls show him lagging his 2020 Democratic rivals in key states.
There were fake polls that were released by somebody. They were fake polls that were either put out by the corrupt media.
And insisting that he's in the best position possible to win re-election.
We have some internal polling, very little, and it's unbelievably strong. The strongest I've ever been is exactly today.
Trump, defiant as Democrats make it clear, they will use their subpoena power to bolster their investigations.
I think what the Democrats are trying to do, because they know they're going to lose the election, so they're going to give this a shot, they're going to just every day they're going to be going more and more.
The president also making this false claim about the Mueller report.
In fact, it said we actually rebuffed your friends from Russia, that we actually pushed them back, we rebuffed them.
But the report made it clear that Trump campaign officials believed they could benefit from Russian help. Trump also talking up his planned meeting with the Russian President Vladimir Putin at the G20 later this month. Even jokingly dangling the prospect of inviting reporters into the room for the meeting.
You people are so untrusting, so it's probably better if I... Would you like to be in the room? Okay? Would you like to be? I can imagine you would be. I think it's probably easier if we have people in the room, because you people don't trust anything.
President Trump was also asked to clarify his comments about the letter that he received from Kim Jong-un yesterday. The president called it beautiful, appreciated, and warm, but it would not add more detail about what was in it. But a source tells CNN's Kylie Atwood that it did not offer a path forward for talks with the United States about denuclearization, which suggests that those talks remain stalled as of today. Jake?
All right, Abby Phillip at the White House, thanks so much. Let's chew over all this with our experts. Sabrina, let me start with you. The president's answer right there, it's not what I meant, it's what I said. Do you have any idea what he is saying? I feel like maybe I'm missing something here.
Well, look, I think that the challenge with this president is that he continues to try and create this alternate universe where facts don't matter, where his own previous statements no longer matter. And he was really all over the place on everything from North Korea and Russia to the polls, lashing out as usual at the media. And I think it's really once again, a somewhat surprising move for a president who is grappling with or who can tout a successful economy. He's mounting his campaign for re-election, and he himself is in many ways his own worst enemy because he can't focus on the issues. And instead, you see him really once again just taking it to the media and using his familiar tactics to try and create this fictional universe where everything is fine and well.
But imagine what Japan, and you know, countries in that region are in South Korea are thinking when they see that. What do you mean that's not what you said and that's not what you meant? And I think the confusion that this is causing internationally is problematic. I'm sure Mike Pompeo's phone was ringing off the hook, as it probably always does today, because how do you plan? How do you study? How do you rely on the United States when the president is can you know, change his mind on a whim and on, you know, day to day, moment to moment?
Didn't you interpret his remarks yesterday as, I would never okay such a CIA operation to, you know, to use Kim Jong-un's half brother to spy? I mean, that's how it seemed like he was saying.
Mm-hmm. I think that's what he was saying, and I hope it's not true, and I hope our enemies don't believe it, and I hope we go ahead with whatever we have going. I would say this, though, politically, you mentioned, Sabrina, the attacks on the media. I read the transcripts, skimmed the transcripts of focus groups with weak Trump supporters. So these are people who voted for him reluctantly in 2016. Will they stick with him? The one thing Trump has succeeded in doing, they hate the media.
Right.
They don't believe anything. The liberal media is out to get him. It's a total. So we think of this, oh, come on, here we go again with the fake news, enemy of the people stuff. It's both wrong in many cases and really irresponsible and demagogic. But if your strategy is to keep everyone who voted for you last time, we could then say that's not quite enough. But that seems to be Trump's strategy, and maybe win a few over randomly once the Democrats nominate someone who's not so great. That the attacks on the media work. And in North Korea, one of the most interesting things in this focus group, he's doing fine in North Korea. So the moderator said, really? I mean, I don't know, hasn't he kind of been rebuffed that it didn't really work? Well, look, you got to try for peace. There's been no price paid. And he seems like, you know, it's a good idea to, you got to pretend to like people sometimes if you want to make a deal with them. The degree to which he's convinced at least, not just his base, though, but even, I'd say, reluctant Trump supporters mm-hmm. on some of these issues, maybe I at least find I've underestimated. I assume that this seems ridiculous, but, you know, they're sort of willing to give him the benefit of the doubt.
But a question also is, what kind of news are they getting? What are they consuming? You know, and if they're consuming certain news outlets that don't ever talk about the bad things, then it's actually not happening. So I think that, and I think that's something we have to take seriously. A lot of times people will say, well, you know, this is just so-and-so. This person is supporting Trump even though he said these terrible things. Well, they don't know that he said these terrible things because it's actually not being covered by the media outlets that they're watching. And so, you know, I would be very interested in that case. And I think, you know, it was frankly, I think it's substantively terrible, the attack that he's done on the press, but it's tactically brilliant in the sense that he's never really held accountable for anything because so many people who are supportive of his now just say, well, that's just the fake news, well, just making stuff
and,
up. And they just are able to look the other way. And
he's been doing this with anybody that tries to provide any sort of accountability, whether it's critics, Republican critics like Jeff Flake,
or whether it's Fox News during the primary.
Robert Mueller.
I mean, this is part of his playbook from the very beginning, and he bent Fox News to his will eventually.
Right. And ultimately, we'll take a look at this. Here's President Trump talking about the poll numbers, disputing that he's doing poorly in internal polling.
I'm not a huge believer in polling. I think you go out there and you fight and you don't really need polls. You need ideas more than polls. But we have some internal polling, very little, and it's unbelievably strong. The strongest I've ever been is exactly today.
Now, his own people say that that's not true, that his internal polling shows him in trouble in some key states. But in terms of, I'm not a huge believer in polling, here's the president's tweet from 7 last night. It's a Rasmussen poll, so it doesn't hold much water with a lot of polling experts. But he tweets about polling all the time. Then this kind of contradiction doesn't matter to his base.
Well, he tweets about the polls that show him in a position of strength, and he dismisses any poll that shows him trailing his likely opponents as fake news. And that's something that he also did in 2016. The New York Times, of course, did report this week that Trump's own internal campaign polling had a pretty devastating result, showing him trailing in as many as 17 states, including several that he has to win in order to be able to be reelected. He was in particular trailing former Vice President Joe Biden, and he instructed his aides, of course, to deny the results of their own poll. But I think that ultimately it's important, though, to note that in 2016, a lot of the polling was off, so you can't put too much stock into some of these poll numbers early on. But I think the more he talks about these polls, the more you get a sense that they actually have gotten under his skin.
But that's also another thing that he got wrong that Abby pointed out, is he said that the Mueller report suggested that he and his team rebuffed efforts by the Russians to insinuate themselves with the Trump campaign. That's a lie. That's not true.
No.
They didn't rebuff them at all.
They didn't rebuff them
at all. They took meetings with them.
In fact, they welcomed it. Yeah. That's awesome, or whatever Donald Trump Jr. said at that point. But, you know, as Sabrina said earlier, I think it's Trump creating his own reality. What's in the Mueller report is what he says in the Mueller report. He also said that he was totally exonerated. He was not. That is not what the Mueller report said. So, but he's counting on the fact that people either didn't read it or they believed what his attorney general said about it and have kind of dismissed it. And as we've seen, a lot of the opinions about the Mueller report are baked in, and he's relying on that at this point. But I want to make the point, when we're talking about the polling numbers, don't listen to what the president says, listen to what the president says. Because him going after Joe Biden like he has in the last, 24 hours, part of it is a response to Biden himself, but we've seen this progressively. He keeps on attacking Biden. It's because he's threatened by Biden.